As you can see on my first slide, I come from Germany, from the University of Duisburg-Essen. I will show you in a minute where this is in Germany. In my for my person, I'm an inorganic chemist, but we also have a Center for Nanoscience, Nanointegration, CNIT, and our work is related to this. So, first to show you where I come from, this is, well, more or less Western Europe. Tomsk must be somewhere here, it's not on the map, but here is Essen, in the western part of Germany. Here's Cologne, which you may know, here's Paris, London, and so on. So here's Essen. Our university consists of two parts. It used to be two universities, which were fused together to make one larger university about 10 years ago. It was the University of Duisburg, as you can see here, the University of Essen. That means today we have two campuses, one in Duisburg, one in Essen. This distance is about 25 kilometers. And we have a third campus, which is the medical faculty. At our university, we have 11 faculties, almost all faculties, which you can have at a university. We have 415 professors, 2,500 academic staff and technical employees, about 37,000 students. Our university is one of the 10 largest German universities. And we also have many international students incoming and also outgoing. For research, it is important that nanoscience is a focus of our university, and also biomedical sciences, and together biomaterials and nanobiomaterials falls into these two objectives of our university. So, so today, I would like to talk about biomaterials from the centimeter to the nanometer scale. So starting from larger objects and then going to smaller objects to the nanoscale. These are some examples for biomaterials which are currently used in biomedical sciences. These are metallic stents for coronary arteries to keep them open. These are screws for orthopedic research, traumatological research. This is an artificial hip joint. These are tooth implants. A joint of alumina, aluminum oxide for artificial hip joints as well, bone substitution materials, an artificial artery made of Teflon, and biodegradable screws made of polyesters. So many biomaterials are used today in medicine, and we use all classes of materials to make them: polymers, metals, ceramics, and composites. So I would like to talk about heart tissue first, and about bone will be my first example for biomaterials. This is a microcomputer tomogram of bone, of human bone, and you can see the special porous structure of the bone. There's a strong clinical need for bone substitution materials. There are many, many bone transplantations every year in medicine. 500,000 or 1,000,000, it's not really counted, there are no good statistics. But surgeons need synthetic bone substitution materials because there are many clinical indications like trauma, bone diseases, tumor extractions, and so on. And there are not too many options how to replace lost bone. You can use autologous bone transplants, your own bone, but you do not have too much bone which you do not need. Then you can use bone from other people, allogenic bone transplants, then you have the infection problems. You can use xenogenic bone from animals. There's an unlimited supply, but you have strong problems with immunology, immune responses, and infections as well. And you can make synthetic bone substitution materials. Well, a good bone substitution material must be biocompatible, non-infectious, storable, biodegradable, mechanically stable, and inexpensive. I would like to show you some of our results in this area of research. Well, before we start with bone substitution materials made synthetically, I would like to tell you something about the structure of bone itself. And the next images are taken from this very nice review article from Weiner and Wagner, who have described bone on 7 different levels of organization from the nanometer scale to the centimeter scale. So the structure of bone starts on the nanometer scale. The major components are calcium phosphate nanocrystals, which you can see here. These are transmission electron micrographs of calcium phosphate nanocrystals in bone. And these are nanofibers made of collagen, which form the organic component of bone. So on the nanometer scale, they are the main or the primary building blocks of bone. If you go to the next dimension, the collagen fibrils are mineralized. That means the calcium phosphate nanocrystals are in these polymer protein fibers. As you can see here as black dots or black objects in this collagen fibril. If you look on this crystallographically, structurally, you find out that these bone nanocrystals of calcium phosphate, these are the crystals, these are the collagen molecules. The nanocrystals are platelets. They all have the same size and shape. They're even crystallographically oriented with their C-axis parallel to the long axis of the collagen fiber, and they are all in parallel. That means even on the nanometer scale, bone is very highly structured. If you go to an even next higher level, these fibrils are organized into arrays to form bone. Depending on where you are in the body, you have a different organization of these fibrils. You can have newly grown bone than it looks like here, so it's not very well organized. A bone had to be grown very rapidly. This is older, mature bone, where the fibrils are better organized because the body had more time to make this bone. If you go even one step higher, you have the cellular level. Bone is a living tissue with cells inside. Cells have to be nurtured. There are arteries and capillaries in bone, and on the micrometer scale, you have the porous structure. The next level is the difference between spongy bone inside the bone, which is porous, and cortical bone, compact bone on the outside. And the highest level is the three-dimensional structure of whole bone, which is responsible for the stability of our skeleton. But it all starts on the nanoscale. Bone consists of nanoparticles of calcium phosphate and nanofibers of collagen. Well, chemically, if you have a look on this, bone is a composite material. From the standpoint of a material scientist, it's an inorganic mineral, calcium phosphate, apatite as nanoparticles, an organic matrix, collagen, and other non-collagenous proteins responsible for the elasticity. The inorganic mineral is responsible for the hardness. The amounts are about comparable, one part of collagen, one part of calcium phosphate, more or less. But together, bone is elastic and hard, and there's this very nice saying, bone is soft as butter and hard as rock. Bone is elastic and hard at the same time. Normally, materials are either hard, a ceramic, but not elastic, or only elastic and not hard, like a polymer. Bone is both elastic and hard at the same time. The mineral phase of bone, if you have a look from chemistry, chemically it's hydroxyapatite, but with many ionic substitutions. This is the formula of ideal hydroxyapatite, but all these ions can be substituted. You can substitute the cations for other cations, even like heavy metals. If you have a heavy metal intoxication, these lead or cadmium ions will go into your bone or into your teeth. You can substitute other ions for phosphate or for hydroxide. So in reality, it's a little bit more complicated. Well, the main substitution in human bone mineral is carbonate on phosphate positions, and we call it a carbonated apatite in the form of nanocrystals. Now, coming to our experiments, I would like to show you a setup how you can make calcium phosphate nanoparticles for bone substitution to have a material, a ceramic, which is nanocrystalline and has the same composition like bone mineral. This is the setup we developed a while ago, and I would like to explain it to you. So we have a calcium salt solution and a phosphate salt solution. We can add some carbonate, like ammonium phosphate plus ammonium carbonate, and here calcium acetate or calcium nitrate. We pump these solutions together in a precipitation vessel, and there calcium phosphate precipitates because it's a sparingly soluble inorganic salt. Now, these small crystals which precipitate would grow to microcrystals if you let them in the water for a while. Therefore, we have a continuously running process. There's an overflow And we continuously pump the solutions inside. We have calcium phosphate nanocrystals which precipitate, and there's an overflow, and the residence time in the vessel depends on the flow rate and also on the volume of the precipitation vessel. A typical residence time is 30 seconds or 60 seconds. Then that means the particles precipitate as nanocrystals, they go into the overflow on a filter, the water is removed, and the nanoparticles can be collected here on the filter. They cannot grow to microcrystals because the water has been removed. That's a very easy setup to prepare nanoparticles of calcium phosphate. Well, this is an X-ray powder diffractogram. If you know the technique, you will see what that means. If you don't know it, just compare the graphs. This is an X-ray powder diffractogram of natural bone. This is our nanocarbonated apatite, and you see it's more or less the same X-ray diffractogram. That means we have nanocrystals of apatite. In the scanning electron microscope, you can see the nanoparticles here. These are small spherical particles with a diameter of about 50 to 80 nanometers, all more or less the same size and shape. If you go to the high-resolution transmission electron microscope, which we have done in collaboration with people from Madrid, who are very good with this technique, you can see that the nanocrystals, the nanoparticles, consist of many small crystalline domains. So this is a crystalline domain of apatite, this is another one, and this whole object is one nanoparticle. That means one nanoparticle is not a small single crystal, it is composed of many even smaller crystallites with a dimension of 10 or 20 or maybe 30 nanometers. This is atomic resolution, by the way, so what you are seeing here are really the planes, the lattice planes of the calcium phosphate and the nanoparticles. Well, if you want to use this as a bone substitution material, we have to make the way from a powder to a solid object. And for this, we used cold isostatic pressing, which is a method to do compaction without high temperature. And we prepared a number of objects, different size and shape, and they are really mechanically stable. And that's what you can see here. They have a compressive strength of 20 to 50 megapascals for compact cylinders. If you are not an engineer, these numbers do not mean anything to you. Therefore, we have, so this is a cylinder. We've made this experiment. We took a cylinder, took it below the foot of one very heavy graduate student with 100 kilograms or so gross weight, and that's what you can see here. And this cylinder, with no problem, withstands this pressure of 100 kilograms, and that's the same more or less as this compressive strength for an area of 1 square centimeter. So you can prepare really objects of nanoparticles with cold isostatic pressing. They don't change their shape, they're still nanocrystalline, and that's what you can see here again in the powder refractogram. Even after shaping into cylinders, they have the same nanostructure like the mineral in natural bone. Now I would like to come to the next chapter. The next chapter is about transfection. If you are a biologist or come from medicine, you should know what that is. If you are a material scientist, you probably don't know what that is. I learned it about 10 years ago. If you are for the non-biologists, I will briefly explain what that is. Transfection is the non-viral introduction of DNA into living cells. You all know that DNA encodes the formation of proteins. Our genome consists of DNA, and the DNA encodes the formation of proteins, the genetic code. Now, if we bring a foreign DNA into a living cell, and the cell is processing this DNA, it will start to produce the corresponding protein. This is a way for genetic manipulation of cells, of living systems. Viruses are doing this all the time. If you have a viral infection, the viral introduces his DNA into your cell, and the cell starts to produce the viral proteins. You can do this also without viruses if you use nanoparticles. Then it's called transfection, and it's clinically interesting to treat genetically caused diseases. We all have small defects on our genome, So where the DNA is incorrect, therefore the protein synthesis is incorrect, and we have some diseases. And transfection is a way to correct this. You bring the correct DNA into the cell is producing the correct protein. So we prepared calcium phosphate nanoparticles coated with DNA. That's what you can see here. Again, precipitation in a reaction vessel. You have calcium phosphate nanoparticles. They're taken with a syringe and mixed with DNA. If you do this rapidly after a few seconds, you have calcium phosphate nanoparticles coated with DNA, which remain nanoparticles. They do not form microparticles. They stay on the nano size and do not precipitate. It's what you would call a colloid. And this is what happens. Ideally, we have nanoparticles carrying DNA. They're taken up by the cell. This is a cell by endocytosis. We have an intracellular vesicle which opens. The nanoparticles and the DNA enter the cell nucleus, and the cell is starting to produce the corresponding protein. You need a nanoparticle as carrier. If you incubate cells with DNA alone, it does not work because DNA cannot penetrate the cell wall. You need a nanoparticle. And we used calcium phosphate nanoparticles. So these are calcium phosphate nanoparticles coated with DNA. Depending on how we make them, they are smaller or larger, scanning electron and transmission electron micrograph, with a diameter of about 100 nanometers. Chemically, we think it works very well with DNA because the DNA has this phosphate backbone, and we think there's some chemical interaction between the calcium phosphate and the phosphate groups of DNA to make something like a non-covalent interaction. And DNA is sitting on the surface of the nanoparticles. Now we had to test this hypothesis. Is the calcium phosphate nanoparticle bringing the DNA into the cell, and does the cell produce the corresponding protein? And you can do protein analysis, that's one way, which is complicated, but you can also make a rather elegant experiment, I think, which we did not invent, it was known before. But there's the so-called enhanced green fluorescent protein, which is a protein which gives green fluorescence. So if it is there, you can see it in the fluorescence microscope. And the DNA which encodes this specific protein is also known. Therefore, if we bring this DNA into the cell will start to produce the enhanced green fluorescent protein, and the cell is green in the fluorescence microscope. That's what you can see here. These are all cells. This is a cell, this is a cell, this is a cell. Some cells are green fluorescing, and some cells are not green fluorescing. Then we can just count green cells and not green cells and determine the efficiency of transfection, how many cells have taken up the DNA and started to produce the corresponding green fluorescent protein. This is a proof of principle experiment. So conceptually, you have a cell, you have a DNA plus a nanoparticle. The DNA has to go into the cytoplasm. It has to go into the nucleus, because in the nucleus, the DNA is read to produce proteins. And if everything has worked well, the transfected cell produces the enhanced green fluorescent protein, then it's green. In a cell culture experiment, we have many cells, many nanoparticles carrying DNA. And then we can count green cells and not green cells and compute the transfection efficiency. In this case, 33% of 4 out of 12. So we have done this experiment, and the transfection efficiency was very small, 1% or 2%, which was very disappointing. So we tried to increase the amount of DNA, the amount of nanoparticles. This all did not help. The problem is that the DNA is degraded inside the cell. This is the pathway I've shown you. The problem is here. Cells have enzymes, nucleases, which destroy foreign DNA. It's a way for a cell to protect itself against foreign DNA. Now, if the DNA is on the outside of such a nanoparticle, it can be easily degraded by enzymes. It will never reach the nucleus. So therefore, we have to protect the DNA. That was our idea, to coat the nanoparticles to prevent the degradation of DNA. What I've shown you so far are the single-shell nanoparticles, calcium phosphate core, DNA outside, which can be attacked by enzymes. So it's unprotected DNA. What we did was to add another layer of calcium phosphate around to protect the DNA inside, and then a third layer to make a colloid chemical stabilization. Then we have triple shell nanoparticles, calcium phosphate core, DNA protected, calcium phosphate, and DNA on the outside for colloidal stabilization. And this really works. These are single shell, double shell, triple shell nanoparticles. These are cell culture experiments. You can just see how the number of green cells increases, single shell, double shell, triple shell. If you make this quantitatively, you can see here that the concept really works. We can increase the number of transfected cells by protecting the DNA. Now, this was transfection to make a cell produce a special kind of protein. There's also another way to influence a cell. This is called gene silencing or small interfering RNA therapy. This is a way to inhibit the production of a specific protein inside a cell called gene silencing. This is done by small interfering RNA, which is more or less the same as DNA, but a smaller molecule. And this you can selectively inhibit the protein biosynthesis. And in this case, we used cells which were all green at the beginning. They all had this green fluorescent protein, and we added RNA to turn off the production of the green fluorescent protein. This means at the beginning, all cells were green, and after treatment, ideally, all cells lost the production of green fluorescent protein. So conceptually, you have a cell which produces EGFP, green fluorescent protein. You add small interfering RNA plus nanoparticles. This has to go into the cytoplasm, and it already works in the cytoplasm. It does not have to reach to enter the nucleus, and the transfected cells is not green anymore because the protein biosynthesis has been inhibited. In a cell culture experiment, all cells are green at the beginning. We add nanoparticles plus RNA. The cells process it, and then in this case, we have a 50% transfection efficiency. 6 out of 12 cells are not green anymore. So this is a way, the other way around, to turn off the production of proteins. These are calcium phosphate nanoparticles functionalized with oligonucleotides. We started in a project with Lomonosov Moscow State University at this time. So 100 nanometer diameter, spherical. And this is a cell culture experiment. Control, all cells are green, single shell and triple shell nanoparticles. In this case, we turned off 27% of the cells. In this case, we turned off 48% of the cells. So that's what you can see here. And you can also see here that RNA alone is not efficient. It cannot penetrate the cell membrane. We need nanoparticles as carriers. Cells take up nanoparticles, and they carry DNA or small interfering RNA or other molecules. So summarizing this part, we can turn on the production of proteins with DNA, and we can turn off the production of proteins selectively in a cell with the help of nanoparticles. And you can read more about this if you want in this review article. We can make the nanoparticles fluorescing to follow their pathway in the cell. There are two ways to make calcium phosphate nanoparticles fluorescing: an inorganic chemical way and an organic chemical way. The inorganic chemical way is to substitute calcium partially by europium or other lanthanoids. Then we have a red fluorescence. That's what you can see here in overlay. This is a cell culture experiment. This is fluorescence micrograph, light microscopy and overlay. We see the red fluorescing particles inside the cells. The organic chemical way to make a nanoparticle fluorescing is to add a fluorescing molecule, and we synthesize the porphyrin, the phosphate groups, to have a good attachment to the surface of the nanoparticles. And that's what you can see here, the cells with the nanoparticles inside. So we could follow their way in the cell. They're really taken up by the cell. Now some real application of nanoparticles. These all were model experiments, just to see, are nanoparticles taken up by cells? Can we influence cells? And this is a part of a larger research project together with China, with Wuhan University, where about 15 groups are working on this, on viral infections. And our idea is to stimulate the immune system with nanoparticles. It's a little bit biological now, even more biological. It's about fighting viral infections. You all know that we suffer from viral infections, but typically our immune system is able to fight them. But sometimes the immune system is not able to fight viral infections, like hepatitis. If you have an hepatitis infection, hepatitis C, it will stay in your body forever. Our immune system is not able to fight it, or AIDS, for instance. And our idea is as follows. There are cells in the immune system, so-called dendritic cells. They see how enemies, bacteria or viruses, look like. They take up the virus or the bacterium and present the signal to so-called T cells, which are killer cells, and tell the killer cells how the enemy looks like. And the T cells then come and kill the bacteria and the viruses. So a very easy explanation, or simple explanation. For this, we use calcium phosphate nanoparticles, some molecules which stimulated the immune system. These are molecules which tell the dendritic cells that an enemy is there. They need to be active. They need to do something. So our system in this case was calcium phosphate core, stimulating agent, CPG. HA is not hydroxyapatite in this case, but hemagglutinin. This is a peptide, a part of the influenza virus, to tell T cells how the enemy looks like, in this case the influenza virus. This is as a first shell. Then we have another layer of calcium phosphate around to protect all this material, and then an outer layer of CPG, which is an oligonucleotide used for stimulation. These triple shell nanoparticles are taken up by dendritic cells, and the dendritic cells take the nanoparticles. They are stimulated by CPG, so they are activated, and they present the hemagglutinin on their surface to T cells, and then the T cells know that there's an influenza infection. So done by nanoparticles. That's what you can see here. These were T cells which are specific for hemagglutinin, and their proliferation is strongly enhanced in the presence of nanoparticles which had been given to dendritic cells. So this is a two-cell culture experiment. Dendritic cells take up nanoparticles and they activate T cells, the killer cells, to fight the infection. For this, we investigated how to purify such nanoparticles and how to study the composition of nanoparticles. If you come to a physician with your nanoparticle dispersion, he asks, what is the dose of your biomolecules? How much do I have to apply? For this, you have to know exactly the composition of your nanoparticle, which is not easy because you cannot analyze one nanoparticle. So with a combination of fluorescence, spectroscopy, UV spectroscopy, and ultracentrifugation, we analyzed the composition of such a nanoparticle, and we can really say the weight of the core, then the CPG, the first shell, and the peptide in the first shell, the second shell of calcium phosphate, and the outer layer of CPG of the oligonucleotide. So we can really analyze nanoparticles, but it's not easy to analyze nanoparticles on a quantitative way basis. That's what you can see here. This is after synthesis, 53% of the calcium phosphate is in the nanoparticles, the remainder is removed. 61% of the peptide is in the nanoparticles, this is removed. And 57% of the CPG of the oligonucleotide is in the nanoparticles, this is removed. Therefore, we really know that we have a pure system, and we know the concentration of biomolecules, which you have to know for any medical application. This is a proof of principle experiment we made. In practice, we took everything which was fluorescing, which we had in the lab, and functionalized nanoparticles of calcium phosphate. So two oligonucleotides, one red, one green, BSE, bovine serum albumin, a protein, and an antibody, polyethylene amine, a polymer, porphyrin, and a peptide. So we made nanoparticles with these fluorescing molecules, and as a control experiment, we just took the fluorescing molecules. And this is the cell culture experiment. This is a ligand one, this is oligonucleotide. This is always one cell with a cell nucleus stained in blue with DAPI. And you can see here, together with nanoparticles, cells have taken up the fluorescing molecules. Without nanoparticles, the cells do not take up the molecules. Therefore, we need nanoparticles as carriers of molecules across a cell membrane. If you have synthesized a drug which is active inside a cell, it has to penetrate the cell membrane somehow. If it does not penetrate the cell membrane alone, you need a carrier, which can be a nanoparticle, because nanoparticles are taken up by cells. Therefore, we can use nanoparticles as carriers for drugs inside cells. We can also make a cell-specific addressing. We made a chemical functionalization of the surface. We added a layer of silica by using silica and silane chemistry. And then we could covalently functionalize nanoparticles to make either thiol or amine terminated surfaces. And there we can do chemistry. One way is to add antibodies to make it cell-specific. So by covalent coupling, we can add an antibody, and then the nanoparticle, in principle, recognizes cells and is taken up only by a specific cell type. Or we can add fluorescing molecules to make the nanoparticles even better fluorescing, a covalent attachment. This really works, as you can see here in the cell culture experiment. These are cells. These are the green fluorescing nanoparticles. This is the red fluorescing protein. It was green in the talk before. Now we took another protein, which is red. So transfection induced by nanoparticles, the cells are red because they read DNA and produce the protein. This is the overlay cells producing the red fluorescing protein and the nanoparticles in the cells. We can really address cells. And this can also be shown with a mixture of cells. These were splenocytes from mice, which contain many different cells. We incubated with nanoparticles, which were specific for dendritic cells. And by FACS analysis, we could show that dendritic cells were preferentially addressed by these nanoparticles. So this is an antibody functionalization of nanoparticle for direction into cells. Okay, in the final part of my talk, I would like to tell you something about silver nanoparticles. And silver is also popular here in Tomsk and Novosibirsk, as I have learned and heard and know, of course. Silver is very popular due to its antibacterial action. And we are investigating this in a coordinated project together with people from biology, Professor Köller, and people from physical chemistry. This is a bigger framework of about 30 groups who work together in Germany on nanoparticles and biological systems, and we are working on silver nanoparticles to understand how they interact with cells, why they are toxic, are they toxic, how they are taken up by cells, and so on. Well, silver is very prominent, as you can see here. These are a few nanosilver-containing products on the German market. Out of about 300 worldwide, there are about 1,000 nanosilver-containing products on the market. 300 in Germany, like socks for preventing the odor of sweat to kill bacteria, mobile phones, silver sprays for feet, plasters with silver, nanosilver against bacteria and fungi, and so on. About 300 products on the German market. Well, silver is important and studied by many groups worldwide, not only by us, because it has a well-known biological effect on microorganisms and also on higher organisms, like humans. It's used in many commercial applications. It has become very popular in the last 10 years. It's also been used in medicine to prevent bacterial infections, like in catheters. And the problem is that silver nanoparticles are increasingly used for this purpose. They are released into the environment. If textiles are coated with silver nanoparticles and textiles are washed, the silver is released into the environment. It has been estimated that already now it's several tons of silver which comes into the environment or sewage plants during washing silver-coated textiles. And there are many publications, but if you really look on the details, the biological actions of silver ions and silver nanoparticles is there, but the difference is not really clearly understood. That's why we are working on this area. We prepared our own silver nanoparticles. There are different ways to make them. In practice, you always have a silver salt, silver nitrate, which is reduced to metallic silver, and you have to prevent the growth of silver nanoparticles by suitable capping agents like PVP, polyvinyl pyrrolidone, or sodium citrate. You can reduce with glucose, so there are different ways, and we prepared silver nanoparticles by three different ways. You can analyze their size and shape. You have a colloidal dispersion. You need to know how large the particles are, what shape they have, how many of them are in your sample. You can use dynamic light scattering or disk centrifugation, just to give you particle size distributions, or zeta potential measurements to measure their charge, negatively or positive charge. And I want to show you one method which we have acquired about 2 years ago, which is rather new, and it's also very instructive for people from the physical or biological sciences, because you can see Brownian motion of nanoparticles as a live imaging video. The principle is as follows. You have nanoparticles in a dispersion, and you have a laser which comes from the side here, and you have scattering of the laser light from the nanoparticles. And here you have a dark field microscope which sees the light scattering from the moving nanoparticles. So you're not seeing the nanoparticles themselves, you see the scattered light. And they are moving all the time due to Brownian motion. If you look into theory of physics, Brownian motion means that small particles are moving fast and large particles are moving slowly. Therefore, by analyzing the speed of the particles, we can compute their size. That's what you can see in the next slide. So it works here. This is Brownian motion analysis, NanoSight, that's the company which markets this instrument. What you are seeing here are moving nanoparticles, silver nanoparticles in a dispersion. The size is not related, the size of this object is not related to the size of the nanoparticles, it's only an optical feature, whether the nanoparticle is in focus or out of focus. Therefore, sometimes the nanoparticles disappear because they go out of focus, down, or too much up. But the computer, maybe we can start it again. Yeah. But the computer is following all these trajectories of the particles, and then it can compute the speed of the particles, and it can compute their size in a particle size distribution. So this is another complementary method by Brownian motion analysis to study particle size distributions of colloids. And it's rather instructive, I think. Now we made different silver nanoparticles. Depending on how you make them, you can make them larger or smaller. You can make cubes or rods or small spheres, depending on the synthesis composition. And of course, the biological action should be different for all these different kinds of particles. This is transmission electron microscopy, citrate functionalized silver nanoparticles, PVP, polymer functionalized silver nanoparticles. You see that they are not single crystals. They consist of several crystalline domains. But we can make them rather homogeneous with a well-defined size and shape. If you look on toxicity of silver, you can compare silver nanoparticles and silver ions. These are cell culture experiments. It's a live-dead assay. Living cells are green, dead cells are black, so we don't see them anymore. This is the control. And these are silver nanoparticles. We are increasing the concentration of silver, and the number of living cells is decreasing, and here they're all dead. These are silver ions, a silver acetate. They have a lower critical concentration. That means ions are more toxic than nanoparticles, but the difference is not too large. 4 micrograms per milliliter, 2.5 micrograms per milliliter. That's what you can see here. Just the number of living cells as a function of concentration. You see at a certain concentration, the cells are dead if you added silver. Now we made a surprising observation. A typical experiment like this works that the chemist is making a silver nanoparticle dispersion. The chemist is giving the nanoparticles to the biologist for the cell culture experiment. And this, the biologist is making the experiment with the cells whenever he has time. So this can take a week or 2 weeks or 1 month, depending on the situation in the lab. And he had made the observation that old nanoparticles, which had been stored for a while, were much more toxic than young, freshly prepared nanoparticles. Age-dependent toxicity of silver nanoparticles. control organ cells. If we use freshly prepared nanoparticles, well, many cells are still living. But if the nanoparticles had been stored for 1 month in the fridge at plus 5 degrees, cells are all dead, and for the even older nanoparticles as well. That means the toxicity depends on the age of the nanoparticles. That's what you can see here as well. These are freshly prepared young nanoparticles. These are old nanoparticles, and they are much more toxic than freshly prepared nanoparticles. And the reason is that the nanoparticles have changed. In the case of silver, the nanoparticles have been oxidized to release silver ions. That means the old nanoparticles consist of still nanoparticles, but also silver ions in the medium, in the solution, and the silver ions are much more toxic than the nanoparticles. So this was our idea, and we probed this by a special experiment to separate silver ions from silver nanoparticles. This was done as shown here. We had the nanoparticles in a dialysis tube where only ions can penetrate. Nanoparticles always stay in the tube. They cannot penetrate the dialysis tube. Then we had an ultracentrifugation step. If any nanoparticle would have been let through, it would be precipitated here. Then we added nanofiltration to be sure that we measure only the ions during the aging process. And these are typical concentration curves. Silver nanoparticles really change over time. At the beginning it's fast, then it's slower, but they really change, they release silver ions. So for this example, after 2,500 hours, 12% of the silver is present in ionic form and 88% is present in metallic form. That's the reason why these particles are much more toxic than these. Now, if you want to determine toxicological concentrations, it depends on the nature of your nanoparticles, on their history. So the numbers are very difficult to interpret. If you look on particle size distributions, you would not even notice this. Even after 45% dissolution in dynamic light scattering, the particle size distribution curve is more or less the same. This is because of the third power. The volume and the weight is the third power of the radius, and all these methods probe the radius. Okay, as a final part, I want to show you some analytic results for silver-containing cosmetics, which are probably also sold in Russia. I'm sure that you can find them if you look for them. This is a toothpaste containing micro silver. It contained about 0.1 microgram silver per gram. We analyzed the noble metal concentration. This is a toothbrush with silver, which we did not analyze because it doesn't make sense to give a concentration. This is body wash with silver, 2.7 micrograms of silver per gram. This is hand cream, 2.7 milligrams, factor of 1,000 between these two, silver per gram. And this is a deodorant, liquid deodorant, also containing some silver. Well, if you are not happy with silver, with the antibacterial action, you can go to even more noble metals. You can buy gold, night creams, nano gold, silk, seide, night cream for women containing gold. And for men, it's an anti-aging cream with platinum containing platinum. There's a very small amount of gold in this night cream and less platinum that we could analyze with our methods. So there's no detectable platinum in this, but this sells for about 80 euros. So there's a lot of money in these things. The interesting thing is that, okay, silver has an antibacterial action, this makes sense, but gold and platinum do not have any biological action. So there's no reason to put on a gold night cream or a platinum night cream or something, but it sells. Of course, the price is much higher than without platinum, but that's not due to the high amount of platinum. So if you want to buy this, think about this first. We made a rough computation. The value of the noble metal in these packages, and that's practically negligible, except for the silver hand cream, 15.6 cents of silver, if you would take out the silver and sell it as silver. But the noble metal content really does not matter, but the price is much higher for these cosmetics. The problem is that silver can kill bacteria, but silver cannot kill all bacteria. Therefore, you may kill the weak bacteria, and the resistant or strong bacteria will come and stay on your skin or on your feet or somewhere. And bacteria may develop a resistance against silver. So it's a problematic thing to use silver everywhere. And gold and platinum have no physiological effect except for commercialization. There's no reason to use it, but obviously these things are bought by people who buy them, spend a lot of money. Okay, as the final slide, some conclusions, because we put together biomedicine and nanoscience, what I think, as take-home messages. So nanoparticles can serve as carriers of biomolecules in the body and into cells. They can be made fluorescent to permit tissue-specific imaging or inside a cell. Cells take up all sorts of nanoparticles, silver, calcium, phosphate, and many others. They can be surface functionalized to allow cell and tissue specific recognition, at least in theory. If you look on the toxicological action of nanoparticles, if you look on this in detail, not much is known, really. It depends on the system you are using and the fate of nanoparticles in the body, like gold. If you are incubating a patient with gold nanoparticles as anti-tumor agents or something, nobody knows where the gold is staying. Does it enter the kidney or the liver or your brain? It's not really known. It's very difficult to analyze. If you go into physical chemistry, you should note that nanoparticles may agglomerate in biological media. Therefore, in fact, you may have microparticles, not nanoparticles, in cell culture media. So there's a difference between pure water and biological media. And if you have a close look, the toxicological nature of nanoparticles is very difficult to define. And for regulatory bodies, who have to give some limits for toxicology or so on, it's very difficult to give a concentration because the properties of nanoparticles depend on many parameters, size, charge, shape, functionalization, and so on. In principle, it's not sufficient to say, I have got silver nanoparticles. You need to say which silver nanoparticles, which size, which shape, which charge, how many of them, and so on. In the body, it's very difficult to follow nanoparticles, remember? And that's what we call nanomedicine at the moment is a very promising field, I believe. But if you have a close look on this, it will be very difficult to regulate because we have to regulate medical treatments because the system is very, very complicated. So with these words, I would like to finish. I would like to thank my co-workers. Here's Dr. Primack, who will give a talk after me. Mr. Page is here. He's also sitting at the first row, a graduate student of mine. And I thank you for your attention. Thank you. First, you have to follow the way of the nanoparticle in a cell, which can be done either by fluorescence microscopy, that's one way, but there's the diffraction and optical limit of 400 nanometers resolution. Even in confocal microscopy, it's 400 nanometer resolution, which is large compared to a nanoparticle. The other way is to use transmission electron microscopy, which often introduces artifacts, and nanoparticles are really very small. A cell is 10 micrometers, a small nanoparticle maybe 5 nanometers. It's very difficult to find a nanoparticle in a cell. To my impression, it's very difficult to follow the pathway of nanoparticles to understand the system. In practice, they are taken up by endocytosis, and they are excreted by exocytosis or somehow out of the cell. I believe that they do not accumulate in the cell. They are excreted, put out again. Then they are in the blood or somewhere. Yeah.
And the coagulation of these nanoparticles,
Yes, yeah, that may happen, that they agglomerate in the cell and then you have something like microparticles. Yeah. But it has been shown by making radioactive nanoparticles of silver and gold that they, in mice, they go everywhere in the body. So you can inject radioactive nanoparticles and then take the mouse, kill the mouse and take it apart and measure radioactivity in all parts of the mouse, in the brain and the kidney, and they are everywhere in the body. Yeah, well, silver is not very often used because it's toxic also to cells, but gold is very prominent, or silica is also very prominent, or carbon nanotubes by some people. We use calcium phosphate because it's biodegradable in the cell, and because the body already knows calcium phosphate nanoparticles from bone and teeth, so it's a natural nanoparticle. And it dissolves. We have shown that it dissolves in the cell with acid. The fate of a gold nanoparticle in the body is not really known. A gold nanoparticle will never dissolve, so it has to stay somewhere. But of course, there are other options. Like silica, I think it's also a very good option because silica is biodegradable and not toxic, so that's another way. But there's not only one solution to the problems of the world. I think there was a question over there. It depends on the size. For these nanoparticles, it's either endocytosis for smaller ones or macropinocytosis for the larger ones. You can show this by adding endocytosis inhibition molecules, so they're inhibitors for endocytosis and for macropinocytosis. So you can block these entrance pathways. Over time, they tend to agglomerate. So over a week or 2 weeks, they tend to agglomerate and to precipitate. What we are doing is freeze drying. Then we have a freeze-dried nanoparticle solid material which can be redispersed in water again. But they are not stable for 1 year or so. But silver or gold, they are stable forever. How the cells can release nanoparticles? If the nanoparticle is dissolved in the cell like calcium phosphate is taken up by endocytosis, then the endosome fuses with the lysosome where we have acid, a low pH, and then it dissolves into ions, calcium and phosphate ions, and they are pumped out as ions. Other nanoparticles, I think there's a discussion among cell biologists. I'm not a cell biologist, but my colleagues say that nanoparticles are excreted by exocytosis. So you can incubate cells with nanoparticles. They take up nanoparticles. And then you mix the cell culture with other cells which do not have nanoparticles. After a while, you have the nanoparticles everywhere. That means they're exchanged between the cells, which can occur only by exocytosis followed by endocytosis again. But I think it's not fully known. Here. So what we are doing is so we have the nanoparticle with DNA in this case, and we add a small layer of silica, and then we do a covalent functionalization. And this is an antibody which is specific for one cell type. That's the idea. It's not our idea. Many people have done this before, of course. This is a protocol. This? So we have prepared the nanoparticles. This has been done in vitro, like in this case, with primary cells, pinocytes. What you see, this is nanoparticles with an isotype control antibody, which is not specific for dendritic cells. This is specific for dendritic cells. So even with a non-specific antibody, 16% of the dendritic cells have taken up these nanoparticles. But with a correct antibody, 95%. So the ratio is 4-1 or so. After 8 hours, the ratio is only 2-1. The message is you can do some cell-specific addressing, but cells also take up the wrong nanoparticles, which is the main problem in nanobiomedicine, because cells take up all kinds of nanoparticles. We have done in vivo experiments with mice, and our colleagues say that dendritic cells are preferentially addressed by the correct antibodies. But the other ones are also effective. It's difficult.